Welcome back to another episode of Swamp Stories. For this episode, we do something a little bit different. We head back to a time that many of us did not exist in. And if you did, Doug, you might be getting old. Anyways, I've wanted to make this video for a while, but I figured that it had already been done. And on top of that, I assumed that everyone already knew these stories. Well, turns out I was wrong and wrong. So it's only right that I dive right in. But before we get into it, make sure to leave a like and subscribe if you're new. You can also follow the Instagram page as well. So let's get into it. We now live in a time of celebrity parody where NBA rivals spend summers together and rappers create fake drama to sell an image. And because of this, many people reminisce about the old days, back when things were authentic, at least that's what they thought. Rap music had become the symbol of toughness and going against the grain, and it was exemplified by two sides, the East Coast and the West Coast. And this became a bitter rivalry that no one understood, but the rivalry started way before it actually started. So let's head back to the beginning in order for this to make sense. In the late 1970s, it all started in the Bronx neighborhood of New York City. That's where a DJ named Kool Herc is credited with making the first hip-hop beats. And this is how it went. A DJ would play beats on the loudspeaker, the whole neighborhood joined around, and then someone would hop on the microphone. And once this trend became a staple in the Bronx, the first rappers began to emerge. Names like Afrika Bambaataa and Grandmaster Flash started gaining major popularity. But they had a major issue. The industry wanted nothing to do with this new trend. It was seen as explicit, which is actually a lame excuse because rock music was way more explicit. The only difference is that rock music was, you know... And on top of this, the music labels and radio stations didn't even want to classify it as music, so the rappers had to find their own way to be heard. And there was only one way to do it, cassette tapes and train stations. They went to each borough throughout the city and distributed their tapes on every block. And over the next few years, the music began spreading like a wildfire. But as the music spread further, it also began to adapt to the different regions it touched. The New York culture was very matter-of-fact, boom-bap, and straight to the point. And that culture revealed itself in the music. Lyrics meant everything, and it was all about the punchlines. But when hip-hop reached the West Coast, it was bound to change in order to fit the culture. The New York vibe simply didn't fit the lifestyle, culture, or lingo of the West Coast. The West Coast is more laid back and chill, which is like a foreign concept to New Yorkers. Like, I just imagine people in New York waking up angry and start yelling at themselves in the mirror. I can't be the only one, right? Anyways, there is a technicality in this rivalry because the West Coast isn't just one culture. Let me explain. Northern California and Southern California are like two completely different states. And Northern California hates LA. But LA couldn't even care less.
Where are you from, bro? LA? What does that stand for? Loser
assholes, dude. What does SF stand for? Startup failed. Whoa, dude.
But the Bay Area has felt like they came up with the sounds and lingo and that LA steals it and makes it more popular. So LA looks at Northern California like the football player who swears they would have made the league if they didn't tear their ACL in 7th grade. Bro, let's be real, the only reason I didn't make the league is... Shut up. LA did it better, so let's stop the whining. Anyways, West Coast rap actually originated in Northern California when a rapper named Too Short emerged with his debut album in 1987. And the album did extremely well. However, it did not get any love on the East Coast. The West Coast loved it because it was a new sound to their ears, but also because he spoke the word of the West Coast. The topics were as such. Do as little as possible for a girl and see how much she can do for you. That's essentially what Northern California rap was all about, being a player. But on the East Coast, that scene is lame, and it always has been. If you go to Atlanta or New York and try to explain how things work on the West Coast, they will simply not believe you. I know so many people in the Bay Area that survive just on girls giving them money. Girls feel like they owe you for your time. It makes no sense to East Coast people. But not only did they see the lyrics as whack, but they also didn't like that the West Coast was stealing their new genre. Hip-hop was New York music, and the West Coast stole the idea, plain and simple. In fact, Too Short says that back then, even mentioning being from California was off-limits on the East Coast. And that envy amplified the next year when LA came out with the hottest hip-hop group called N.W.A. In 1988, they released their debut album Straight Outta Compton, and it absolutely blew up more than ever expected. But again, the East Coast was not a fan. Unlike Too Short, NWA didn't rap about the life of a player. Instead, they rapped about living through the gang politics of Southern California. Although their lyrics still mattered, NWA was all about the feeling and making a statement. Their music made you feel like it was you against the world, fighting off rival neighborhoods, cops, and corrupt attorneys. West Coast rap wasn't pure and proper like how New York intended it to be. And honestly, they had every right to be upset. They felt like the West was changing what they created. However, these feelings of jealousy and envy were brushed under the rug for a while, mostly because the industry began accepting East Coast rap and trying their best to vilify the West. For example, rappers like KRS-One were featured on the cover of The Source magazine despite selling less records than West Coast rappers. He sold back-to-back gold records, which is great, but Too Short went platinum back-to-back over the same time span. On top of this, NWA was completely rejected by the mainstream media. And even worse, the police refused to protect them while they were on tour. This is a courtesy that police carry on for any large gathering. It's a no-brainer. But for NWA, a statement needed to be made against them and everything they represented. It got to the point where the FBI even sent them a letter threatening to take action against them. Well, not too long after, NWA fell apart because of internal issues and the media finally got what they pleased. But then came the 1990s when the media began to change their stance. The industry noticed a revelation. You can't stop the free market. You can paint the rappers in whatever light you please. The people will still ultimately decide whether the music will continue or not. They could not have possibly painted a worse picture of NWA, Too Short, and whoever else. But that only made the rappers more famous. Ultimately, the people want what they want. So the industry had to adjust their angle. Instead of trying to conceal drama, beef, and gangster rap, they had to promote it. But instead of F the police, let's pin the people against each other and make as much money as possible off of it. Now that's just how I imagine that it took place, but I could be wrong of course, but that's just how capitalism works. Whether you like something or not, you get with the times and try to make as much money as you can. Well, the industry knew about the tensions between the East and West Coast, however, it was not that deep at first before they pushed the narrative. New York was obviously envious of the West Coast taking their music, changing it, and then selling more records than them. And the West Coast saw the East Coast as proper, lame, and lacking style. I mean, in retrospect, that's probably true. For example, Sugar Hill Gang was from a suburban New Jersey town and rapped about PG-13 topics. But that was the extent of the issues by all accounts. And it was really an LA versus New York cultural battle. And it all started in 1991. Let me introduce you to a man named Timothy Blair, more commonly known as Tim Dog. Tim Dog was from the Bronx and he was overshadowed by all the other rappers. And despite not even being a top New York rapper, he decided that the West Coast was the reason he wasn't getting any love. So on November 12th, 1991, he released an EP called Penicillin on Wax. And the entire project was dedicated to dissing the West Coast, but more importantly, NWA. One of the songs was even called Compton, and the lyrics were pretty interesting. After 2 minutes of clowning NWA, Tim Dog made a statement that spoke for the whole East Coast. He said, "What are you even fighting for? Fighting over colors? All that gang shit for dumb m-." Then he said, "Come to New York and see who gets robbed." And after the diss, the media finally gave him what he wanted. Clout. But just like Tekashi Rat-9, shock value only lasts so long, and Tim Dog's career slowly started to vanish. However, New York's condescending view of the West Coast did not, and it only got worse when new stars began emerging. By 1992, the West Coast had new superstars, and it was done in an unconventional way. The old way to make your way into the industry, you had to pass through a major label. Instead, Suge Knight started his own label called Death Row Records. And once Dr. Dre and the DOC left NWA and Ruthless Records, this was the perfect spot. Later that same year, he dropped The Chronic, and many people don't know that he actually dissed Tim Dog on the album. If you know what song, please let me know in the comments. Well, The Chronic went triple platinum and made the East Coast even more envious than ever. And then came Snoop Dogg, who may have passed up Too Short as having the most degrading lyrics of all time. Well, it was degrading to New Yorkers, but us on the West Coast, that's just how the game goes. It's normal for girls to be talked to like that, and it's not even seen as disrespect. Well, ultimately, New York's rap scene was getting played out and corny, just like Russell Wilson. I'm just kidding, but they did need a taste of the future, and that came in 1993 with Bad Boy Records. Sean Combs invested in the Notorious B.I.G. and Craig Mack, and instantly, the East Coast was back in the game. But before the beef between the labels, there was no bad blood in the slightest. And that takes us to June of 1992. So let me set the context. At this point, Tupac is a star, but more for being in the movie Juice than for his music. And Biggie Smalls had a few songs out, but he was not a star yet. Well, Tupac is on the set of Poetic Justice and starts playing a Biggie Smalls song called Party and Bullshit. Well, it turns out that Biggie happened to be visiting the set at the same time. And remember, at this point, New York rappers have no clue how the West Coast are going to react to them. However, Biggie walks over to Tupac and tells him that that's his song he's playing. From there, Tupac shows him love and says that he loves his music. And the next thing you know, Tupac invites Biggie and his New York crew over to his house. He barbecues for them, and then they have a rap battle between the East and West Coast. Everything is good. Biggie even said that they clicked right away and they were cool from then on. Later that year, Biggie even invited Tupac to New York where they performed together and everything. But everything changed on November 30th, 1995. Tupac has a legal case in New York that he has to appear in court for on October 1st, so he heads to New York. Well, Bad Boy Records gets word of his arrival, and their rapper Lil Sean invites Tupac to the studio to perform a verse. So Tupac shows up to the building and walks to the elevator. But right there are three men waiting for him. They demand he give them his jewelry, and after a struggle, bang! The three men run away, and there is Tupac in the lobby waiting for an ambulance. Then Biggie and Puffy rush down to the lobby to check on him, and Tupac flips them off while he's being carried away. He ends up surviving, and here is where everything gets interesting. Biggie and Puffy instantly deny any involvement in what happened. In fact, they said that they knew nothing about what was gonna happen and they wanted to make it right. But let's be logical here. How else would the three men know when and where to locate Tupac? Someone within the Bad Boy circle had to have given the drop on Tupac, and that's exactly how he felt. However, he was unable to voice his opinion for quite some time. That's because he was convicted in a separate case just a few days later. And the most gangster part about it is that the judge offered to move back the case until Tupac fully recovered. But Tupac showed up to the original date in a wheelchair looking like a complete mess. I don't know about you guys, but I think that was legendary. However, what Tupac would do next was not. While at Rikers Island, Tupac would do an interview with Kevin Powell. And during the interview, he blatantly pins the Quad Studio incident on Biggie and Puff. The famous quote is, "I know who got me." Now, in today's time, this would be considered snitching. It's the same thing that Gucci did after he believed that Jeezy set him up. But what do you guys think? Is this snitching? Let me know in the comments. Well, shortly after this, Suge Knight ended up bailing out Tupac and signing him to Death Row Records. And this is when the Battle of the Coasts really began. At every single opportunity, Tupac and Death Row took shots at Bad Boy. However, on the other hand, Biggie Smalls tried to downplay it every single time. And Puffy even visited Tupac at Rikers Island to clarify that he was not involved in any ways. But despite this effort, the West was not trying to hear it, and neither was Tupac. So the disrespect coming from the West simply kept getting worse and worse. And that takes us to August 3rd, 1995. Back in the 90s, the Source Awards were the most important night of the year in hip-hop. People saw the Grammys as being rigged for Starbucks drinkers, so this was really the night for the culture. And Death Row made sure to send a message in front of a national audience. And here's the craziest part. The award show happened to be in New York City. So Suge Knight goes up to the podium with confidence and takes a major shot at Puffy. And here's what he said.
Any artist out there want to be an artist and want to stay a star, don't want to have to worry about the executive producer trying to be all in the video, all on the record, dancing, come to Death Row.
This was a major dig at Puffy for being in all the Bad Boy music videos. Well, the entire crowd boos him, and it only gets worse when Snoop Dogg goes up to receive his award.
The East Coast don't love Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg. The East Coast ain't got no love for Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg and Death Row. Y'all don't love us. Y'all don't love us. Well, let it be known then. We know y'all East Coast. We know we at East Coast and F.
Thankfully, at the end of the show, Puffy went on stage and called for the East and West beef to stop. However, this did nothing to stop it. In fact, this is when the fans got immersed more in the beef. The East and West Coast became complete rivals, and you better know what not to play in each region. That's how serious it was. Well, after a year of waiting, Tupac came up with a master plan. He knew that Biggie was having issues with his wife, Faith Evans, even to the point where the two split apart. So Tupac then gets in contact with Faith Evans. He tells her that he loves her music and that he wants a feature from her. Now at this time, you had to actually be in the studio together because there was no emailing songs. So they meet up at the studio and take a picture. Pac allegedly offers her $250,000 for the feature, which back then is equivalent to $500,000 today. So I would say that Pac was not being serious, and after she does the feature, he actually refuses to pay her. Now this is according to her, so let me be clear. Faith Evans claims that Tupac would only pay her the feature money if she let him, you know what. She then claims that she declined the offer. Well, Tupac had a completely different story, and he would let it all be known on the legendary song called Hit 'Em Up. He says, "I f***ed your wife, you f***." And that became one of the coldest bars in rap history, and it definitely stung Biggie deep down. It's rumored that he confronted his wife about if it's true or not, and she has stayed consistent that nothing ever happened between her and Tupac. However, many fans believe that she's lying, but what do you guys think? Is she shady for even considering doing a feature for Tupac, nonetheless linking up with him? Either way, things would only escalate from here on out. Death Row's group, The Dog Pound, released a song called New York, New York, and recorded the video in Times Square. Well, New York group Mobb Deep would fire back with LA, LA in return, but that was just music and playful dissing. However, what would happen next would shock the country. 1996. At this point, many will tell you that Tupac was at his wildest stage. He felt invincible, or better yet, he just didn't care anymore. He was down to confront anyone, and he never hid behind security. Sadly, this attitude would cost him. And that takes us to September 7th, 1996. Las Vegas, Nevada. Tupac flies into Las Vegas to attend a Mike Tyson fight, but before he goes to the event, he heads to a party. And there, he runs into the Southside Crips, a notorious Compton gang. These guys are known throughout LA, especially for their rivalry with the mob Piru. And they're definitely known to start problems. Well, so is Tupac, and this combination is a disaster waiting to happen. And things turn left when Tupac feels disrespected. So he walks up to one of the men and bap. He knocks down Orlando Baby Lane Anderson, one of the coldest to ever come out of Compton. And this guy just got embarrassed in front of everyone, so you know he's ready to make a statement. So fast forward to the fight, and Tupac has a wild night. Apparently, he was yelling and talking trash nonstop throughout the night. Well, Mike Tyson ends up winning the fight, and Tupac leaves the arena with Suge Knight in his BMW 750. Well, they head down the Las Vegas Strip when a car pulls beside. Bang. Instantly, all eyes are on one person and one person only, Notorious B.I.G. So he, along with Puffy, were questioned by the FBI and were later determined to not be suspects. Instead, rumors started flooding the streets about Southside's involvement. Either way, everyone was still looking at Biggie for whatever reason. So Puff Daddy and Snoop Dogg came together and gave a speech calling for a West Coast, East Coast truce. And they insinuated that Biggie had nothing to do with this. However, that may not have been the case. That takes us to March 7th, 1997. Biggie flies into LAX for the 1997 Soul Train Awards. And at the show, he was booed relentlessly for what happened to Tupac. And on top of this, Tupac's All Eyes on Me won Hip Hop Album of the Year. Well, let's fast forward 2 days later on March 9th, 1997. Compton police receive a tip that Biggie Smalls is at the South Park in Compton. This just happens to be in the middle of the Southside territory. However, this tip was no reason to arrive at the scene, so Compton police let it slide. Rumors hit the streets that Biggie owed them money. For what? Who knows? And apparently, he never paid them. Well, Biggie brushes it off and heads to a vibe party. At 1 a.m., Biggie leaves the party and drives down Wilshire Boulevard. That's when a Chevy Impala pulls up right beside him. Bang! this incident would once again shock the world, and it even caused some people to believe that this was the end of rap music. The genre's two biggest stars were gone within 6 months of each other. However, no one will ever know the truth about what really went down. Did Bad Boy set up Tupac at Quad Studios? Did Biggie set up Tupac in Las Vegas? And finally, was Biggie's passing revenge for Tupac? Either way, the whole East Coast, West Coast drama calmed down after this. And these days, everyone just seems to enjoy the music. Now, I have to admit that Tupac's music withstood the test of time much more than Biggie's. But what do you guys think? Which artist was greater? That's gonna do it for this episode of Swamp Stories. Make sure to leave a like and subscribe if you're new. Peace!